The families, all the different neighbours of the community here in Barrow House. met from her prayer meeting. She met here every Tuesday evening here in Barrow House. Also welcome many others who are joining us online, thanks to live streaming. And take a think of the Chesson family in Luton, and also many of Mark's friends in St. Dunphy's JEA Club. So welcome those here in the church and welcome those joining us online as we gather here to celebrate the life of Peggy. And to capture some sense of the life that we're celebrating here today, I invite Lucy, Peggy's granddaughter, to come forward and to explain some of the symbols which have been presented. Some of the symbols capture some sense of the 88 years of Peggy's long and wonderful life. Lucy. Thank you, Lucy, and thanks for also presenting those symbols. Capture some sense of Peggy's years of life you shared with us here. So I'd like to please now to stand and begin a Mass for Peggy. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And the Lord be with you. God, the Father, we stand here as your family, as we pray for the poor soul of Peggy, as we thank you for her long and wonderful life you shared with us here on earth, and celebrate the eternal life she now enjoys forever in her eternal home in heaven. Lord Jesus, you raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Ecclesiastes, a lovely sense of Peggy who lived life to the full, great sense of the different times of life. There's a time for everything, every season under the sun. There's a season for everything, a season for every occupation under heaven, a time for giving birth, a time for dying, a time for planting, a time for uprooting what has been planted, a time for killing, a time for healing, a time for knocking down, a time for building, a time for tears, a time for laughter. For us, our second reading, a lovely letter from St. Paul to Timothy. St. Paul, writing from his prison cell in Rome, knowing he's facing his own death, is writing to young Timothy, encouraging him to keep on going, telling Timothy the time of departure has come, he has fought the good fight, he has finished the race, he has kept the faith.
The Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. Not only to me, but to all through to all.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still, and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were none, I should have told you. I am going now to prepare a place for you, and after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so where I am, you may be too. That you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." He acclaimed the gospel in song. She now enjoying forever in her eternal home. Peggy was born Margaret Mary Toohey back on the 18th of November 1934 in Gurnalassa in Kenmare, County Kerry, to John and Nora Toohey. Peggy was the eldest of seven children, five girls and two boys. Peggy herself, then Eamon, Anne, who's joining us online from Wimbledon, Sheila, Joan, Marie, Dennis, they've all predeceased her except for Anne and Sheila. She came from a good Kerry family farming background. There were good Kerry farmers at the bottom of Shrahan Mountain. Indeed, lovely to represent the Kerry blood that is in Peggy all her life by the Kerry jersey that's presented, and also the Wolf's Tree, which you saw at the beginning of Mass. Peggy, in her early youth, worked in various different restaurants and various different places. I was asking, how does Peggy from Kerry end up with Leo from Leitrim? And it happened because Peggy, got a teaching position in Haverstown National School, who's there between Kilcullen and Castledonnet. And indeed, it's lovely to see the picture here represented. And apart from that, the picture says, in recognition of all the years of Miss P. Kevill, principal 1959 to 1995. Many years of fantastic service she gave, indeed. She's fondly remembered by so many pupils, so many parents, so many families. Kevin, she's a teacher in Caverstown. And Leo, what Leo doing at Thai? Leo, you're the Midlands Health Board Community Welfare Officer. Indeed, I happened to notice in your home there the other day, a lovely presentation made to you when you retired from being from the Midlands Health Board as well. It's been quite a joy for all your years of service, your dedicated commitment you gave to the Midlands Health Board Community Welfare Officer. Anyway, where did they meet? Like so many at that time, they met in Dreamlands. Dreamlands, go back to the old showband times, they met the dance hall here in the Thai. That's where they first met, and did so many romances started there. They married in Palmerston Church in 1968, and had a young reception in the old West County Hotel. They've always lived here in Barrow House. Originally they lived next door where James and Anna Malone now live, and then Leo and you built your own home in 1972 where yourself and Peggy lived ever since. Did that one a few times last week, and it's a lovely, lovely home of the picture you have there. Blessed with four sons, Paul, Mark, Brian and Declan. And the two of the things that strike me so much about Peggy, one is her love of family, the second is certainly her faith. Her faith, she has the great sense of devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary, constantly praying her rosary, to be affected by the Ave Maria, which will be sung at the offertory. But that's just been changed. It's now World Water because of the Irish. Thank you. Well, it's still to a lady, except that's why. So we're actually love World Water, it's one of my favourite songs. It's in Irish because of the Irish. So the love of the Irish will be reflected there as well, and in the love of the Blessed Virgin Mary, they're singing World Water at the offertory. Also, as we know, as I mentioned earlier, she had great faith that she came here to the Ballard House every Tuesday evening for her prayer group. She's in Clonfair once a month there with Eddie Stones, and she'd go to a Thai church. But it pointed out to me that she actually didn't go to a Thai church. She always went to the Dominican church. We're all aware of the love of Dominicans that were here, and unfortunately, after so many hundreds of years, that they had to withdraw from the Thai. The lack of vocations, but then after that she continued to their great love of the Holy Spirit as well. And again, just know for being in the home, just looking around the home, it's very obvious from all the pictures, statues, and the various things very clearly in the home she's surrounded by that. And also, the family telling me that in latter years, through COVID times, that her routine was to always get the 9:30 mass online from a Thai, and then she watched the 10:30 mass. On RTE, getting two masses a day. Now, even in my book, that's a lot of religion. So a lot of her other loves in life as well. I told her she was a late show fanatic every Friday night. She just wouldn't miss it for the world. She was a good cook, a certain things I'm told. Particularly, she loved her sports. She also loves flowers as well, and well loved receiving flowers. And also, she loved her travelling. Particularly after she retired, Lee one told that she dragged her everywhere. He went to Lake Garda, Boston, New York, with Paul and Brian as well. He went to New York and Washington. He went to Berlin, and various times with John Bond travel different places like Hungary and Europe. And also a regular visit to Mark and family in Luton, especially every year, just before Christmas. Stuff at Crossroads. And also, I'd love to see her diary presented here as well. She'll write in her diary. And also, I'm told every evening she'd walk around her back garden praying the rosary, and how she got into at COVID times. Her son would tell me that when they were younger, they were very energetic. I can only imagine the four of you, Leo and Peggy, there in the home. But I think she's well able for, as a teacher, I think she's well able for her four sons. Don't tell me that as a teacher, she's very much of the good old stock, the old style teacher, religion, Irish, maths, kind of, which you also taught to all her own boys. Then, of course, came the eight grandchildren, which she so dearly loved. Dara, Melissa, Cuiva, Donica, Oisin, Lucy, Sean, Aura, because I've loved those her, Deanna and Eva and Louise, the daughters in law, and kind of just trying some of the grandchildren, just ask about the memories that they call the Granny Peggy. Lucy was telling me that she would always put a smile on her face. She's very jealous of the time. And Dara, I love Dara's comment, and with his permission I'm going to quote it. Dara's memory of Granny Peggy was that every time he went into the kitchen that he was force-fed by Granny Peggy. She was, all her life in the kitchen. And, I was reflecting on it, and spoken to them as reflecting, of all the places in the whole world that Peggy could have died, could you pick a better place than her own kitchen? saw the Brian Decking then at the home when I arrived there, and even though there's a great sense of tragedy and loss and shock and suddenness, there's also a nice sense of peace that I felt there as well. And as we do kind of gather here, I know for Peggy it's a lovely way to die, a lovely place to die. And after a mass here, she's going to be brought to the joint cemetery where Lee and myself bought two plots so that they'd lie, yourself and Leo, each of them plant where you're going to be buried, side by side with her. That was her plan, and to have two plots, two souls in for a forever shape of lie side by side with Leo. But Leo, not too soon. I chose that gospel today because we have many different images of heaven, and where heaven is, we just don't know. But we have many different images of heaven. And for me, my favourite image of heaven is one that Jesus uses in today's gospel. It's at the Last Supper, and he's telling the disciples, you know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas asked that question, which I'm delighted he asked. He said, Lord, we do not know where you are going. Where is Jesus now? Where is Peggy now? Where have they gone? And Jesus gives an answer as to where he's gone. Where's Peggy gone? Peggy's gone home. Home to the Father. Home to God the Father, who's the source of all life. All life comes from God, and all life returns back to him. And Jesus is saying that heaven is not a place to stay. Heaven is going back to the Father, going back home. And God the Father called Peggy from her earthly home here, from her kitchen here, and to call her home to with himself, to so enjoy the fullness of life and eternal home in heaven. Amen. I invite Dara, Lucy, and Kuva to the grandchildren, please, to come forward. Please to stand as we, as family, we pray. We pray for an apostle and Peggy, and we pray for ourselves.
Let us pray for the family, relatives, and friends who will miss Peggy, that they may find strength and consolation in their faith. Lord, hear us.
Lord, Jesus, hear us.
In baptism, Peggy received the
light
of Christ. May that lead her out into the darkness of death into eternal life. Lord, hear.
Lord, Jesus, hear us.
Our son of Welta, Abazir Gordego, Hora Peggy, Abaz Gok, Dina, and Vigar, Dun, Sisail Shaw, Ahirna Tordo, Luke, Seher, Abe, Hassa, Ahirna Aishnan.
Ahirna Aishnan, Sisail.
We pray that prayer that Peggy has prayed so often in life. Each time we pray to Hail Mary, we ask Mary, our mother, be with us at the hour of our own death. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. May these and all our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you please be seated for our offertory procession. The two gifts of bread and wine will be presented by Diana and Yvonne, and they're here at the front of the church. And our offertory hymn will be, as I mentioned earlier, reflecting Peggy's great love of Mary and now the love of the Irish, a widow wife.
Oh,
to deliver to God the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you the sacrifice offerings, O Lord, for salvation of Peggy, we beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful judge. May this up and all our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, and eternal dwellings made ready for them in heaven, so will all the angels and saints who declare your glory as one voice that we sing. Gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and the eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." And so we proclaim the mystery of our faith. We may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Dermot our Bishop, all the clergy, and your entire people. Remember Peggy, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that Peggy, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who died in your mercy. We remember especially Peggy's parents, John and Nora Tookie, her brothers and sisters, Dennis, Marie, John, and Eamon, Anne's husband, Percy, who died in England, Anne's son, Lee, who died 2 years ago, Sheila's husband, Pat, Leo's sister, Anne, and Leo's parents, Patrick and Annie, and all the deceased members of both the Kevin and the two friends. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and with the blessed apostles and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. As family stand, we pray our family prayer for Peggy and for ourselves. Our Father, who art in heaven, graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. So we stand and pray. Let us pray. Lord God, the Son has left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey. May he grant that, strengthened by it, the pagan may come to the eternal table of Christ in our eternal home, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. And the Lord be with you.
And
the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Without your peace, be seated. Before our final prayers of commendation, I invite Declan and Peggy's son to come forward to say some words of appreciation.
Firstly, we would like to thank so many people who have helped us at this sad time. The ambulance crew and K-Doc who helped us last Monday. The Gardaí, especially Garda Robbie Forn from Ballaline, who was first on the scene and stayed with us for a long time and provided us with great comfort. Doctor and nurses in Tala Hospital who have been so accommodating with allowing Leo out at this particularly sad time. Joe Rigby and his staff who have taken much of the load off us at a trying time and treating Peggy with respect she deserves. The Barhouse community and GA Club who have provided us with great supper at this time, especially Alan Lankin, Mikey Lankin, Tommy Phelan and Mikey Whelan, and Michael Whelan, and anyone else who has provided assistance with parking, seating, mugs, kettles, you name it. Our great neighbours like James Malone, who cut the grass in the field next door to provide parking. Unfortunately, we didn't have to use it, but his sister Alice and her husband Sean provided parking as well. Theresa Lankin for the lovely framed photo of a man that we hung over her coffin. Jacinta O'Donnell and accompaniment for the lovely music as per Peggy's wishes. Father Lee Ringley, who gave Peggy the last rites and met us to learn more about Peggy and family. family and did such a wonderful job during this Mass and removal. Also those who helped at the church, services and the grave. All the people who have travelled from all over to be with us, cousins who have come from the UK, cousins and uncles and aunties, family and friends who have come from far away as Belgium and Denmark, as well as everyone who travelled from all parts of Ireland. We really appreciate all the thoughts and the donations expressed to us in person and via different forms of media. To all the people who are unable to be with us today, who joined us online, especially Peggy's sister Anne in London and her son Brian, and others tuning in from the UK, USA and other parts of the world, including the Kevilles in Boston, Fitzpatrick's in New York, and the Gordons in France. If we've left any doubts out, please accept our apologies. Ma, where to start? Wait, I know where to start. You always told us a story, as a story. A story has to have a beginning, a middle, and an end, so I'll start at the beginning. She grew up in Portalasa on the hillside between Kenmare and Tregaron. She had a happy childhood and wanted for little. She went to school through the fields, barefoot in the summer, to Carrick School, where her uncle James was the master. She was lucky on two occasions to survive her childhood. Once when she was a baby, suffered pneumonia and was nursed back to health for weeks by her neighbour, Dan O'Leary, in front of the fire, for which we are eternally grateful. On another occasion, she must have been daydreaming as she walked along the rail line on the way home from school. She didn't notice the train approaching, and only the shouts from her father working in the fields alerted her to the danger. She was from a bright family and won a scholarship to go to secondary school in Killarney and then trained to be a teacher, while her two sisters, Anne and Sheila, trained to be nurses, Sheila going on to become a matron in a hospital in Galway. She was from a family of Kerry rebels. Two uncles of her grandmother were deported to New Zealand from Tuxist in Fianna in 67. The home house of Portalasa was a known safe house, and her dad and her brothers and his brothers were all involved in the fight for freedom. Her uncle Dennis was captured from the home house in May 1921 and cruelly tortured and executed by Crown forces, but he never gave his colleagues up. Peggy was fiercely proud of him, and in May 2021, during the COVID pandemic restrictions and travel bans, Peggy and the extended Toohey family managed to organise a clandestine, socially distant meeting at his grave in Kenmare to commemorate the 100-year anniversary of his death, continuing the rebel tradition. Peggy gave the oration at his gravesite. As such, she was made of tough stuff. One Sunday in 1985, we were up in Dublin, back in the days when Leash could make an Ulster final. Ma wasn't into football, she never even went to any of our matches, so she was sat in the car in Moore Street while we went to the match. She was in the passenger seat reading the paper with her handbag in the driver's seat. Next thing, the side window was smashed in and the handbag snatched. As she said afterwards, well, if he grabbed it, then I grabbed it. And the two of them had a tug of war, but she didn't get Ma's handbag out of the fight and the thief took off empty-handed. The Dublin underworld should know better than to try and park a carry woman from her handbag. She was a teacher in Halberstown for 36 years, from when the school opened to 1995. She didn't just teach, but she cleaned, painted, weaved the garden, fundraised, organised after-school football, delivered religious magazines, you name it. Not many would cope with the long days. Leo said she never got home until 6 p.m, dealing with all that and four young lads messing and fighting in the back of her Fiat 127. No wonder she used to reach for a fag after getting home and facing into a cooking and dinner, which always involved boiling potatoes. She loved the spuds. Paul gave up giving her and Leo pasta or rice or any of that foreign muck, as they always wanted spuds with the dinner anyway. She was never so happy than when James Malone started growing and selling potatoes in the fields next door. She was an old school teacher and was a strict disciplinarian, especially with her own four sons. Mark says her curriculum consisted of religion, Irish religion, and religion taught in the media. She believed in the need for a good education and put all four of us through college, but didn't interfere with our lives unduly. Her relationship advised of, if you make your bed, you can lie in it. As a result, we were probably all late starters in love, fearful of the wrath of Peggy. Her faith was unshakable. She believed the family that prayed together stayed together, and rosaries were common when we were younger, much to our obvious delight. Kneeling on the dance stairs floor for countless mysteries, all of them were sorrowful for us. Even up until recently, every time any of us were leaving our house after a visit, she was out with a 2 litre 7-up bottle full of holy water, dousing people and cars in its blessings. The grandkids used to try to avoid the water. When we were building our house in Scotland, we would bring Peggy to see the progress. She would wander about the site, and afterwards we'd find woolly medals all over the place. In wall cavities, under mattresses, even in the foundations. We're not sure if it added anything structurally to the house, but it definitely did spur it to you. Regular trips to Clonfert were reported with the news that she was praying for us all. And as Sean Fenwick said on Tuesday, who's going to come out again? She loved people and could strike up a conversation with anybody, and boy could she talk. She could talk all night, and often did. She would call in to see friends and neighbours and literally stay up all night. She would leave us in the car sometimes or sleep in their house. It didn't bother her once there was something to talk about. She loved talking to older people especially. She would keep all the old dears in the locality company, even though she was probably older than most of them. She loved travelling in later life, but she couldn't much when she was younger. She got to see much of Europe and New York and Washington, Boston in the US. Whenever we were away, she would get out her atlas and mark off where we had been and when. She was happy to sit in the back of the car and go anywhere with Paul or any of us, praying away and watching the sights. She never complained. Of late, her trips were mainly around her garden praying. She even had a pack worn in the house. She always especially loved the trips home to Kerry and her mountains. Every Sunday when we were down, once the dinner was over, she would bring out the quiz, which was the crossword in the Sunday Independent. Thankfully, in recent years, Google made that a bit easier when we were stuck. Peggy and Leo met in the ballroom from Anson Dreamland Pie during the age of show bands. When I asked Dad the other day how long did it work, he said she didn't believe in doing long lines. I guess both their clocks were ticking as they were in their mid-30s, so they got married in St. Philomena's in Palmerston in Dublin in 1968 and had the four of us in 5 years. They were quite independent living, but inseparable. They did bicker occasionally, but their arguments, often out of politics, would be quickly forgotten. In recent times, when Anna had stopped driving, she would announce to Leo in the morning, "I'm going shopping," which meant, really, you were bringing me shopping, which he duly did, traipsing from shop to shop and even back again if something was cheaper back there. She used to keep a tab of the cost of things and varied her shopping based on the cost of items. Not sure if she counted the cost of Leo's diesel. She was frugal in some respects, but then generous to a fault, a woman with contradictions. As parents, they played good cop with mad and bad cop. This could be seen when I was in college. I'd ring in the morning look for funds for extra books or some extracurricular activities, and was hoping to reach Leo if I was to stand any chance. If the phone was answered, and then a 2 second delay followed by a, "Hello?" in a Kerry accent, I'd promptly hang up, as I knew there was no chance of meeting with her. I must have thought she had a stalker. Leo and Peggy moved to our house in 1968 and were made for feel very welcome and lived a very happy life here, integrating with many aspects of community life and hopefully contributing in some small way. Christmases won't be the same again. She used to visit us all at Christmas and was very generous with her times and gifts for her grandkids. They all loved to see her coming. Dee and Mark used to say Christmas started when Peggy and Leo came across in early December. Yvonne used to bring her shopping in Dublin, and she loved those trips. Louise used to ask her what she wanted, and occasionally she went with, "A frog! I want a frog!" That was promptly followed down Stephen's day with a fashion parade, when we gave her gifts. We have lost our rock, our anchor, our constant, our North Star, our guiding light. We are bereft, unmoored, cut adrift. We don't know how to cope, but with the strength she has given us, we will get through this. She was ready to go, we were just not ready for her to leave. She left us with the minimum of fuss, which was just like her. She would say during COVID restrictions she would love to go then, so there'd be no big deal about her. The rest of us want to thank Paul for minding her and Leo so well for the last number of years. It was a great comfort to us knowing that he was there and looking after them so well. As Paul said on the day she died, "I haven't just lost my mummy. I've lost a great friend. Thank you, man. We're going to miss you. But guess God did you do more. We love you."
So proud of Lee and of all your children and grandchildren. Thank you so very much. great courage to get through all of that. Well done. So I invite you please now to stand for our final prayers of commendation. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of Peggy. May our farewell express our love and affection for her. May these our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again. And the love of Christ who conquers all things destroys even death itself. Responses receive her soul and present to God the Most High. Say to God, come to her help, hasten to meet her angels of the Lord.
Receive her soul and present to God the Most High.
May Christ have called you, take her to himself. The angel lead to the name of his side. Receive her soul and present to God the Most High. Eternal rest back unto her, Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her.
Receive her soul and present to God the Most High.
Let us pray. Into your hands, Father, mercies, we commend Peggy in the sure and certain hope that together all those who have died in Christ, that she will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestow upon Peggy in this world. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. And merciful Lord, talk towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of heaven to Peggy. Help us remain to comfort one another with the assurance of faith. Until we meet in Christ, we are with you and with Peggy forever. In peace, we take Peggy to a place of rest. Peggy, may saints and angels lead you on and escort you where Christ has gone. Now he has called you, come to him and sit upon the seraphim. Come to the peace of Abraham and to the supper of the Lamb. Come to the glory of the blessed.